Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Tasting Beer, Second Edition, an insider's guide to the world's greatest drink, by Randy Mosher. Narrated by Donald Corren. Foreword to the Second Edition. The first edition of Tasting Beer came out in 2009, 1 year after I developed and founded the Cicerone Certification Program. I soon started recommending the book to those looking for a text to guide their studies for the first-level Cicerone exam, Certified Beer Server. Over the years, the connection between Cicerone and Tasting Beer has continued, so much so that some people think Randy and I coordinated to create a text that would serve the program's needs. This is not the case. Rather, it is a happy coincidence that our paths through beer led us to create complementary offerings at about the same time. Cicerone challenges beer professionals to learn about their beverage and its culture. Randy's Tasting Beer addresses the questions posed by every student of beer and, in the process, provides an excellent text to aid in the journey. This second edition of Tasting Beer expands coverage of some key topics that relate to the Cicerone journey beyond the first level, such as draft systems. In addition, I find that the integrated understanding of beer this edition presents would serve those studying for just about any level of Cicerone program exam. Any candidate who has not read Tasting Beer for a few years would be well advised to read this new edition. The connections and insights it offers will help you organize and integrate all of the details you learn from a variety of sources into a more cogent and nuanced understanding of beer. But Tasting Beer goes much further than just knowledge. Its organization and presentation telegraph the decades that Randy has spent thinking about beer. The broad spectrum of his thoughtful studies has led him to understand answers to questions that those with a more focused view have never thought to ask. As a result, he possesses and presents an uncommon understanding of the full universe of beer. And here's the best part. Given the depth of his exploration and the sheer volume of knowledge he presents, you might expect this text to be weighty and ponderous. Such is not the case. Indeed, Randy writes with a precise but conversational voice. The true magic of Randy's work comes in his insights, in his seasoned understanding of how the many facts about beer connect in complex and varied ways to create this living, breathing thing that we capture with the simple word beer. Whether you literally wish to learn more about tasting, or simply hope to garner a basic understanding of beer, Tasting Beer will satisfy your thirst in a memorable way. Ray Daniels, founder and director of the Cicerone Certification Program. Foreword to the First Edition. When I met Randy Mosher, he was coming at me with a hammer in his hand and a maniacal smile on his face. We were at Chicago's Real Ale Festival in 1998, and he was helping prepare casks of unfiltered, unpasteurized, naturally carbonated real ale for serving. His enthusiasm was infectious, as lively as the beers contained in those casks. I have gotten to know Randy better in the last 5 years as we have served together on the board of directors of the Brewers Association. He earned his seat at the table representing the American Home Brewers Association. But in time it became apparent that his perspective, knowledge, and passion encompassed the whole world of beer lovers and makers, enthusiasts, amateurs, pros, and beyond. Randy is a true beer evangelist. In this book, and in all aspects of his beer-soaked life, he is saving souls one pint at a time. Tasting Beer tackles the experience of choosing and imbibing beer with just enough technical and scientific information to explain the events, but not so much that the beer novice feels overwhelmed. Randy doesn't preach his personal preferences here. He celebrates the fact that our individual palates are as unique as snowflakes. Tasting Beer is like a collection of many fine books bound together. beer history, the science of brewing, the disciplines of tasting and evaluation, the wide array of beer styles, pairings of food and beer, beer terminology, it's all in here. This book is like an imperial pint full of knowledge, and Randy's cup runneth over. I am hopeful that tasting beer will find a home with professionals in addition to beer enthusiasts. I can think of no better single tool for brewers, bartenders, connoisseurs, chefs, salespeople, and everyone else in the beer trade for enhancing their beer IQ. Despite the fact that beer's history is as ancient as wine's, and that there are more styles and flavors of beer than wine, beer is still considered a less complex beverage by too many foodies and connoisseurs. Randy helps to dispel this myth in tasting beer. Much of the beer sold throughout the world is some slight variation on the light lager style. But Randy points out that centuries before the Rheinheitsgebot, beers were being brewed with diverse ingredients such as honey, bog myrtle, cranberries, and coriander. Craft breweries today have reinvigorated this ancient tradition using spices, herbs, sugars, fruits, and more. Randy gives equal time to each of the diverse, exciting beers that drinkers are trading up to, from the exotic eccentrics to the popular classic styles. As international beer culture evolves, the brewers of these exciting craft beers are achieving growth and recognition disproportionate to that of the industrial, conglomerate light beer producers. After listening to this book, it is easy to see why. Beer culture is tremendously diverse, distinguished, and nuanced. As Randy writes, like any art, beer needs a proper context to be truly compelling. Tasting beer gives us this context in spades. Drink up as you read up on the world's most storied and beloved adult beverage. Cheers. Sam Calagione, owner of Dogfish Head Craft Brewery, and the author of Brewing Up a Business. Preface. As you listen to these words, consider the beer-filled glass in your hand. Look closely. Study the rich color and slight viscosity of the liquid. Observe the way the light plays on the shimmering highlights. Watch the bubbles as they form and rise lazily through the beer, adding to the creamy foam on top. Hushed and peaceful as a snowfall. Lift the glass to your lips, but first pause to inhale and ponder the aroma. Draw in the bready, caramelly, or roasty foundation of malt, the brisk green counterpoint of hops, and perhaps the swirling cupboard of spices and fruit, earth and wood. These scents can fire off neurons in the forgotten, happy corners of your memory, as powerful an experience as any art form. Finally, have a taste. The beer floods in, cool and crisp, or warm and rich. Observe the first blush of flavor and the tart tingle of carbonation. As the beer warms in your mouth, it releases a new round of flavors and sensations. Malty sweetness, bright herbal hops, a touch of toast, all building to a bittersweet crescendo. It's not one single taste. It's an ever-evolving cinematic experience unspooling as you drink. A soft exhalation presents the nose with a new layer of beery perfume. These pleasures have been savored for millennia. If you can read the meaning in these sensations, the whole history of brewing opens up, and the long process reveals itself in the beer, from golden barley fields to steam-filled brew house to the tireless working of the first domesticated microbe, yeast. The grand finale comes as a long-fading aftertaste, with lingering wisps of resin, toast, or honey, concluding perhaps with a gentle, warming alcohol sensation in your throat. The empty glass, now spent, is clad in an immodest slip of lace. Welcome to beer. I wish it were always this ecstatic, and when it's good, it really can be. Truth be told, We don't always give our beer the attention it deserves, and we are the poorer for it. Like any aspect of a consciously lived life, enjoying beer to the fullest takes education, experience, and a proper frame of mind. That isn't to say that learning to understand and appreciate beer is hard work. It is among the most enjoyable things you can do. But to get the most out of beer, you have to put a little effort into it. This book lays out the experience of beer in all its glory, in a logical and systematic way. Beer may be humble, but it is not simple. Beer is brewed nearly everywhere that grain grows, except, ironically, in its own homeland of the Middle East. It spans the full range of the sacred and the profane, a participant with equal gusto in ancient religious mysteries and raucous frat house revelries. Whether it's essential nutrition and a safe source of water, or an unobtainable luxury, there is a beer to satisfy every need or whim. It may be harvested with sickles, brewed in baskets and drunk through reeds, or conjured up with the simple push of a button in automated space-age breweries. It can be a faceless industrial commodity or an artistic creation as treasured and transfixing as the finest wine. Light, dark, strong, weak, fizzy, flat, canned, bottled, or draft, beer has fluidly adapted to serve every role it has been asked to play, and it has done so with extraordinary grace. Beer is the universal beverage. Yet, despite this impressive resume, it is surprising how little most people know about it. Even the most basic concepts are fuzzy. What is beer? What is it made from? Why is dark beer dark? If we remain uninformed, we can be trapped in our own limited beer world, not knowing what delights we're missing, such as which beer might be perfect with a barbecue sandwich, or when it's okay to send back a bad beer. It takes a little information to open up the extraordinary universe of beer. Beer is a complicated subject, more difficult to grasp than wine in terms of what is actually in the glass. It can be brewed from dozens of ingredients, processed in hundreds of different ways. Unlike the vintner, the brewer actually constructs a recipe to yield a product to suit his or her vision. Every brew requires choice after choice, each of which you can taste in the glass if you understand the process. The many dozens of styles are not fixed beacons, but shifting shoals that change with the tide of generations, each with its own past, present, and future. Finally, bad information abounds. A lot of bad information. A quote from Barnabé Itinerarium by Richard Brathwaite, 1638. The oil of malt and juice of sprightly nectar have made my muse more valiant than Hector. The depth and breadth of beer. In a concise way, this book aims to introduce you to the wide world of beer and to give you the tools to understand and, more importantly, enjoy it. Beer has a history that predates civilization, and in its own way, beer has shaped us as much as we have shaped it. Our complex relationship with beer is the key to understanding its many roles in society, and this, in turn, helps make sense of the cornucopia of colors, strengths, and flavors that form the family of beer. Beer is democratic. It does not depend on the finest real estate or limited geographical designations. The many choices made by the maltster and brewer create aromas, flavors, textures, and colors, transforming a few simple commodities into exquisite works of art. Anyone with skill, passion, and creativity can learn to make great beer. For a taster, each glance, each telltale whiff and studied sip of a beer can be like peering into the soul of the man or woman who brewed it. This dependence on a human rather than a heavenly touch is one of beer's great delights. As a passionate fan of beer, you may be called upon to introduce others to its charms. As with anything else, presentation is half the game. It's not cheating, A great beer, poured into a perfect glass at just the right temperature in the best possible setting, should always be the goal. Anything less cheats the brewer and drinker alike. By the end of the book, and with a lot of practice on your own, you'll be on your way to understanding all the many things that come together to form the wonderfulness of a well-brewed and thoroughly enjoyed beer. From In Praise of Ale, 1888, a collection of old English beer poetry, author unknown. Sack makes men from words fall to drawing of swords, and quarreling endeth their quaffing. Whilst dagger ale barrels bear off many quarrels, and often turn chiding to laughing. The community of beer. Gemütlichkeit is a German word meaning coziness, and it is most often used to describe the warm and cheery atmosphere of the log and taxidermy-decorated bars in such places as Wisconsin. It's a great word, for it has a broader and more important connotation that I like to think of as cousinness. I'm referring to a sense of easy community, where people in a certain space have decided to put aside differences and suspicions and consciously work at being convivial. The Czechs, Dutch, Russians, and Danes have similar concepts in their languages, but English has to borrow the German term. There is definitely something about beer. Look at the mirth just bursting out of those Bruegel paintings as Flemish peasants drink beer and dance despite their rough and challenging lives. Civilization and civility thrive where there is a pot of beer. Beer brings people together on common ground and has been doing so for thousands of years. The business of beer has a good deal of the same camaraderie. In an era when market competitors and most businesses loathe each other like Cold War rivals, such antipathy is hard to find in brewing. Marketing people may go at it hammer and tongs, but brewers are pals. Maybe it's just the satisfaction of being a member of the small club of people who absolutely, positively know that what they do for a living makes a lot of people happy. Beer today. Times grow ever more interesting for a good beer. While classic styles remain meaningful, the action is with creative brewers hell-bent on pushing the art forward and making a name for themselves, encouraged by their fans looking for the next big thing. Everywhere, brewers are looking for ways to make the beers their own, incorporating local ingredients and cultural attitudes into the final product, often in thrilling ways. There are breweries specializing in wild and wood-aged and spontaneous beers, culinary botanic and foraged beers, farm-brewed beers, ethnocentric beers, cask beers, session beers, lost historic beers, and many other specialties. Despite many examples of sublime subtlety, most craft beers are bold, even brash, an antidote to so much that is bland and faceless out there. The great brewing traditions of Britain, Germany, and Belgium may be brewed with reverential attention to authenticity or viewed as just loose starting points. There is an arms race going on. From the use of massive blasts of hops to the imperializing of every imaginable style, craft brewers are piling on the flavor. At the top are super gravity beers, currently weighing in at as much as 27% alcohol, right up there with port and close to the level of spirits. Some, like the Samuel Adams Utopias, sell for upwards of $200, stratospheric for the beer world, but still a bargain by the heady standards of the exotic spirits world. At the same time, there has never been more interest in sessionable beers that pack plenty of flavor into their modest gravity. In England, real ale, once the national drink, has become a specialty beer, and there is an alarming shift away from drinking in pubs, driven by cost, driving restrictions, and other factors. The fantastic classic Belgian beers we love represent just 15% of their home market. Germany rightly loves its beers, but given the sameness of many of them, the place is ripe for consolidation. The same could be said of the Czech Republic. But in all those hallowed beer capitals, a new generation of brewers is breaking with stifling tradition, trying to make their local beers meaningful, fresh, and exciting again, and sometimes breaking the mold altogether. Increasingly, the past inspires the future. Many obscure styles are being reanimated into living, breathing things. Just look at the explosion of tangy, salty Goza and other North German outlaw beers in the United States and elsewhere. Shoveled onto the scrap heap by the bulldozer of modernity in the early 20th century, these and other antiquated styles are finding favor with brewers and drinkers thirsty for their appealing blend of authenticity and creativity. Whatever the historical reality of farmhouse beers, the notion is irresistibly charming today in our industrialized world. As a result, brewers are happily translating that idea into characterful, drinkable beers, often brewed with rustic touches such as oak and wild microorganisms that bring a lot of depth into these otherwise simple creations. Hops, which only recently threatened to subsume everything else into a sea of green bitterness, are now stepping back into their rightful place as one of the ways to make a delicious and characterful beer. However, hops remain so popular that IPA has radiated into a whole cascade, pun intended, of variations. White, red, black, rye, Belgian, Brett, and session, as well as India pale lagers. At the same time, many craft brewers are looking to move beyond hops, seeking to brew something meaningful using local food and drink traditions, as well as indigenous plants. From Alaska to Australia, there is huge interest in creating beers that incorporate local ingredients, such as Sitka spruce tips, roasted wattle seed, imbirana wood, prickly pear fruit, dulce de leche, red rice, chestnuts, figs, bog myrtle, kupawasu, wormwood, and elderflower. It's a thrilling adventure. Fruit beer has finally gotten serious. A few brewers are creating beers with a fruity impact more along the lines of a fine wine. Sugar, too, is out of the closet, and brewers are using such exotic types as piloncillo, rapadura, and Belgian brewer's caramel to lighten the body and enhance the drinkability of stronger beers. Wheat, rye, buckwheat, and other unusual adjunct beers abound. Pumpkin ales are popular around Halloween, and chili beers pop up from time to time, as do the ancient techniques of stone beer and smoked malt. Bourbon barrels have found their way into breweries, yielding vanilla and toasted coconut notes to strong beers after a few months of aging. The late and sorely missed beer writer Michael Jackson was fond of shocking audiences in the 1990s Europe by saying that the United States was the best place on the planet to drink beer. He was right. And there continues to be more styles, more choices, and more beers bursting with flavor and personality in the United States than anywhere else. It wasn't always so. By the mid-1970s, there were pitifully few American beers worth drinking. The lack of a living beer tradition worth preserving left us free to build a new beer culture from scratch. A new generation of American brewers took to the task with passion and imagination. Within a few short decades, their efforts have put craft beer at the forefront of desirability, share of mind, and flat-out coolness, if not in total market share. The success of their tasty, characterful craft beers inspired the rest of the world, and today, it's a fully international movement. Frank Zappa once famously said, "You can't be a real country unless you have a beer and an airline." Today, craft brewery, or even IPA might be a better measure. They're everywhere, and more are on their way. Craft brewing is a business, of course, but it's much more than that. It's a movement with artistic, social, and political dimensions. Given the obstacles in distribution, raw materials, profitability, equipment, taxation, and competition, the sense of mission helps brewers endure in the face of such steep odds. There are more battles to come. Having failed to come up with much innovation on their own, multinational brewers are gobbling up many of the more successful craft brewers as a way to get closer to their hip, young consumers and authentic brand stories. This is not a problem in itself, but already there are moves to solidify their portfolios and lock out independent brands from their powerful distribution networks, a very troubling development for small brewers that should be equally alarming to enthusiasts as well. In the past, most of these acquired brands have failed to materialize into the powerhouses they expected. Compared to the 1990s, big brewers have learned to not try to reinvent their craft acquisitions in their own image. But time will tell if they can resist the urge to tamper, and whether they will get where they wanted to go with them. Despite the potential storm clouds, it's a very good time for beer. Craft brewers everywhere remain passionate about their calling to make delicious and creative beer, stay close to their fans, and sustain the kind of businesses of which we all can be proud. I'll definitely drink to that. Beer really is the world's best beverage. It may be quenching or nourishing, cooling or warming, simple or worthy of deep meditation. It is a drink of 1,000 aromas, a rainbow of color, and a range of character as diverse as the people who brew and enjoy it. It has 10,000 years of history, with gods, goddesses, heroes, and songs to celebrate its glories. It brings us together. Beer makes us happy. In tasting beer, it is my hope to help guide you to a better understanding of the many things that make beer and our relationship with it so magical. With effort and information, you can gain the power to peer knowingly into its amber depths, approach it with keener senses, and find within the meaning of beer. From The Bacchanalian Song by Mr. Phillips, from In Praise of Ale, 1888. Come fill me a glass, fill it high, a bumper I'll have. He's a fool that will flinch, I'll not bate an inch, though I drink myself into my grave. Come, my lads, move the glass, drink about. We'll drink the whole universe dry. We'll set foot and drink it all out. If once we grow sober, we die. Chapter 1. The Story of Beer. Beer is the great family of starch-based alcoholic beverages produced without distillation. Today, in the industrialized world, beer is usually brewed from barley malt, with other grains such as rice, corn, wheat, or oats thrown in for reasons of cost, texture, or tradition, and seasoned with hops. This is but a small subset of all possible beers. In the vast span of history, and in the diverse cultures of pre-industrial societies, many other variations are found. Every imaginable starchy vegetable product has been used, even manioc and millet. The starch in grain is not readily fermentable by brewer's yeast, so some chemical process must be used to break down the starches into fermentable sugars. For Andean chicha, women chew maize, and enzymes in their saliva do the trick. In sake, yes, it's beer, not wine, aspergillus fungus is used to provide the necessary enzymes. Fortunately, grains such as barley and wheat already contain enzymes capable of doing the job when given the opportunity. We know beer as a delicious treat. These days, it is not essential for survival. But in the days of poor sanitation, just a century or two ago, beer was one of the few cheap, safe sources of potable water. Beer can also contain a lot of protein and carbohydrates, depending on how it is brewed, and this has earned it the nickname liquid bread. Beer also contains alcohol, long prized for its ability to ease social tensions and create a sense of well-being, despite the risks to those who overindulge. Beer can be brewed to suit many different tastes and for a host of different purposes. It is typical to see, in most cultural contexts, a range of beers from weak to strong, filling different roles in the day, the season, or the society. Those who study the birth of civilizations and beer note that the two happened at just about the same time. Barley was one of the earliest cultivated grains, and the fact that it emerged in domesticated form with just the right characteristics for brewing tells us a lot. Leaving the nomadic life behind for a pot of gruel is one thing, but toss in a beer, and it's a hard deal to turn down. It is my belief that squeezing people into cities generates a certain amount of itchy friction, but this can be eased by a social lubricant like beer, served up in that other beloved institution, the tavern, which appeared on the scene not long after beer. Beer, in many times and places, was not a casual consumer choice, but something much more meaningful. The ancient Middle Eastern peoples had gods and goddesses dedicated to the stuff, and they wove the creation of beer into their own epic tales. In the Sumerian epic of Gilgamesh, it is a sip of beer that makes the wild man civilized. In Egyptian legend, it saved the world. Through the millennia, beer has been accorded the highest possible status in culture after culture. We owe it to beer to understand it, to nurture it, to respect it. Like all human art forms, it survives only at our pleasure. We get out of it what we put into it. A little beer history. The history of beer is a wide and deeply fascinating subject and deserves a great deal more attention than I'm going to be able to give it in this short chapter. All I can hope to do here is lay out the broad strokes so that the rest of the pieces, especially with regard to styles, will fit into the framework I'm providing. Agriculture's start. The story begins around 22,000 BCE, as the last ice age ended and changing climates made the part of the Middle East, now known as Kurdistan, more habitable. As people settled the area, they made use of wild harvested plants, including grasses, as a good source of nutrition and more. Chemical evidence from a place called Göbekli Tepe indicates that people may have been brewing beer from wild grasses as early as 15,000 BCE. By saving the best seeds and replanting year after year, they bred these grasses into barley and wheat, and as they did, turned themselves into farmers and brewers. Their domesticated grasses had large, starch-swollen seeds well-suited to the foods and drinks they produced. Their wheat had plenty of the sticky protein called gluten that gives structure to leavened bread, and the grains threshed free of their gritty husks, another vital characteristic for good bread. Their barley had less gluten than wheat, and many varieties threshed with the husk intact, two qualities that are very helpful in brewing. The full story is fairly complicated, but even in that early era, the fundamentals were there for barley beer and wheaten bread. Recent evidence has pointed to a similarly early date for beer brewing in central China, first with rice, and then, contemporaneously with the rise of civilization in the Near East, with barley and sorghum as well. It is unclear how mashing, the enzyme conversion of starch to sugar, was discovered. It is postulated that the essential step of malting, sprouting the grain, then drying it, which also activates the starch-degrading enzymes, was originally done to preserve the grain and to add to its nutritive value. And in a day when the gruel du jour must have been monotonous in the extreme, it may have livened things up quite a bit when somebody discovered that if you mix malt with hot water, a few minutes later you get a nutritious broth that is quite sweet. It actually tastes a lot like grape nuts. Staking their fate on the cultivation of those tiny grass seeds was a bold step for these ancient people. Animal herding was well suited to a nomadic lifestyle, as people followed the herds season to season in search of pasturage. Grain is not particularly portable, so throwing your lot in with agriculture meant the loss of a certain kind of wind-in-the-hair freedom. Personally, I find this loss much more acceptable when the trade-off is beer as compared to bread or gruel. Those more scholarly than I make the claim that beer is one thing that allowed people to come together in unnaturally crowded settings, such as cities. It's certainly true today that beer helps to take the edge off and make cities much more livable. I'm not pointing any fingers, but look at the places where beer is absolutely forbidden. It's easy to see the contrast. It appears that wine and beer developed at about the same time and place. Even in that early day, wine was a much more luxurious product, by and large reserved for royalty and other upper crusty types, while everyone drank beer. The Greeks, and the Romans after them, propagated this notion of wine superiority that has come down in a direct line ever since. Consider this the next time you are banging your head in frustration over the automatic sense of class and status accorded to wine relative to beer. I do believe we have the power to change this to some degree, but it is important to know what we are up against. Beer in ancient civilizations. The Sumerians were the first great civilization of the ancient Middle East. They were very fond of beer. Their word for beer, kash, literally means what the mouth desires, and this gives us a good idea of how central beer was to their culture. By 3000 BCE, the art of beer was well established, as evidenced by an expansive vocabulary of ingredients, brewing vessels, and beer types. Malt kilns made red, brown, and black beers possible, and there were fresh and aged, strong and weak, and even a diet beer, the name for which, ebla, literally meant lessens the waste. Yeast was known as the motive power of beer, but its nature would remain a mystery for another 5,000 years. In that day, women were the brewers as well as the retailers of beer, as they were in Europe throughout the Middle Ages. It's not surprising that the Sumerian deity of beer, Ninkasi, was a female and a daughter of Ninhursag, the mother goddess. There is a detailed poem, the Hymn to Ninkasi, which describes the brewing of beer. Here's an excerpt from it, translated by Miguel Seville. Ninkasi, you are the one who spreads the cooked mash on large reed mats. Coolness overcomes. You are the one who holds with both hands the great sweet wort, brewing it with honey and wine. Barley was malted, kilned, and ground. It was then either formed into conical cakes and baked, or used as is. Baking the cakes would have added some caramelization and presumably begun the enzymatic conversions of starch to sugar. The cakes would then have been a kind of instant mash, and adding them to hot water would have been an easy and portable way to get brewing started. The beer was often drunk out of a communal vessel through long straws, typically made of reeds. High-status individuals had straws made from more precious materials. The Babylonians, Akkadians, Hittites, Phoenicians, and other ancient Middle Eastern people were also beer lovers. The Bible does mention wine frequently, and something called shechaur, which is usually translated as strong drink. Scholars seem to have come around to the view that this could refer to beer, but it may also refer to any alcohol other than grape wine, including beer fortified with dates, figs, or honey, or wines made from them. But just across the desert, in Egypt, we see beer on a grand scale. Breweries were associated with temples there and were similar in size to the brew pubs of today. Egyptian beer was called hekt, and because of its near-industrial scale, brewing was in the domain of men. Beer was such a vital staple of Egyptian life that a model brewery was seen as essential to ensure a happy afterlife. Beer, along with bread and onions, is credited with fueling vast construction projects, such as the pyramids. As in Mesopotamia, the beer was often brewed from specially prepared cakes of malted barley. Much of it was bottled in tall clay jars with special clay seals. There is a tale from Egyptian mythology that shows the value that culture placed on beer. Sekhmet, the lion-headed woman, was the goddess of destruction, blood, and periodic renewal. Her father, Ra, the big daddy god of ancient Egypt, felt that humanity was backsliding and was not worshiping him in the manner to which he was accustomed. So he sent Sekhmet out to teach the people a lesson. Things got out of hand, with a lot of hacking and smacking and drinking of blood. If she were to continue, humanity would be destroyed. So, someone had the bright idea to give her 80,000 jars of red beer to drink as an alternative to all that blood. And just to play it safe, they laced the beer with mandrake root, a powerful sedative. She drank it, and went to sleep, and humankind was saved. Who wouldn't think kindly of beer after a close call like that? Vestiges of this ancient beer tradition still survive in Egypt and the Sudan to the south in the form of a primitive folk brew called bosa. Indigenous brewers there still make cakes of malted barley to brew this chunky and nutritious beer. From Eber's Papyrus, 1552 BCE, may you have bread that doesn't crumble and beer that doesn't go sour. The Greeks believed wine to be the drink of civilized people. For them, the defining characteristic of barbarism was beer drinking. Their disdain for beer, however, didn't stop them from stealing the very hip god of beer, Sabazio, later Attis, from the beer-drinking Lydians and Phrygians to the north, stripping him of his dignity, doling him up with a crown of leaves, renaming him Dionysus, and enthroning him as their very own god of wine. Evidence of the Phrygians' fondness for beer comes to us by way of their famous ruler, King Midas. Archaeologists in the 1950s dug down through an ancient mound in Gordion, Turkey, into a heavy timber structure. Once inside, they found a burial site, determined to be that of Midas himself, holding the remains of a funerary feast. The objects were recovered and put on display, and scrapings from the cauldrons and drinking vessels were stored away for future analysis. Their time came a few years later when a professor from the University of Pennsylvania named Patrick McGovern happened upon them. He was using molecular archaeology to research the early history of wine. Using sophisticated analytical methods, such as gas chromatography, McGovern was looking for individual molecules of substances that would offer clues to the nature of ancient foods or drinks. What he and his team found, in addition to a lamb and lentil stew, was a drink containing barley, grapes, and honey. To announce the results, a party was held, for which Sam Caligioni, of Dogfish Head Craft Brewery, was asked to make the beer. This evolved into a regular product, Midas Touch. It is impossible to say how much this modern brew resembles the ancient one, but it is delicious and gives us a tantalizing glimpse into the lives of these ancient beer-loving people. The Romans, just like the Greeks, whose culture they absorbed, never did warm up to beer. This points out a key fact of beer geography. There is a line south of which grapes grow well and wine becomes the dominant drink. North of this line, ancient Romans encountered enthusiastic beer drinkers at the fringes of their empire. Beverages made from grain mixed with honey or fruit occurred throughout ancient northern Europe. Honey is a willing, if scarce, source of fermentable sugar, and grapes harbor yeast. The dull, waxy haze you see on the surface of grapes is actually brewer's yeast in its natural habitat. This was known in ancient times, and it appears that grapes or raisins were sometimes added for the purpose of kick-starting fermentation in beer. Other ingredients found their way into beer and other drinks as well. Images of poppy pods suggest that opium was involved in Dionysian rituals. Further afield, the Scythians, in present-day Ukraine, seem to have been enamored of hemp. Greek writers of the time report sauna-like tents with heated rocks inside, upon which they threw hemp, which, Herodotus notes, gives off a vapor unsurpassed by any vapor bath one could find in Greece. The Scythians enjoy this so much that they howl with pleasure. Chemical analysis of scrapings from Bronze Age burials has turned up barley, honey, cranberries, and two herbs, meadowsweet and bog myrtle, Filipendula ulmaria and Myrica gale. At this time, the widespread adoption of hops was still far in the future. The Kalevala, the national epic story of the Finns and Hungarians, has a delightful account of the creation of beer, which took a great deal longer to explain than the creation of the earth. Asmotar, the brewster, aided by the magic maiden Kalevatar, is desperately seeking fermentation of the beer she's just brewed. They try pine cones and bear spit before resorting to honey, which works like a charm. Upward in the tub of birchwood foaming higher, higher, higher. There is also a strong and very old tradition of incorporating juniper in these northern brews, which continues to this day in the unhopped Finnish farmhouse ale called Sati, a delicious and unassumingly strong brew made from malt and rye, in which juniper is added to the water as well as the mash, the branches are used as a filtering bed, and the wood is made into drinking vessels. A little south, in the British Isles, beers seasoned with heather were being brewed by the Picts, the original inhabitants who built Stonehenge before the Celts displaced them. There is a delightfully romantic tale, described in Robert Louis Stevenson's poem Heather Ale, about the last of the Picts, who allowed his son to be flung over a cliff rather than reveal the secret of heather ale to the advancing Celts. As it's difficult to find any spot in northern Scotland without heather in sight, it's not hard to fathom what the secret was. But it's still a great story. The beer-drinking barbarians left the world with many gifts, not the least of which was the wooden barrel. It's a technological achievement of amazing durability, maintaining the same form and construction since its first creation around 0 CE. Barrels were largely phased out of everyday use for beer by the middle of the 20th century and have now returned for special purposes. For spirits and wine, nothing else serves quite as well. Beer in the Middle Ages. In the Middle Ages, beer and brewing settled into the familiar pre-modern pattern. Women called alewives brewed beer on a domestic scale, and its sale offered a reliable source of income for widows or others in need of honest cash. There were also institutional breweries, either monastic or owned by landed gentry, as well as some commercial or common breweries. These became more widespread as time went on. Prior to 1000 CE, almost all beer in Europe was brewed without hops, seasoned with a pricey mixture called gruet, sold by the holder of the local gruetrecht, or gruet right, which was the usual coterie of bigwigs, church, state, or in between. The purchase of gruet was mandatory for brewers, serving as an early form of taxation. A testament to the importance of gruet still stands in Bruges, Belgium, in the form of an opulent building now serving as a medieval folklife museum. The composition of gruet was a big secret, and its spices were mixed with ground grain to further confound would-be counterfeiters. Bog myrtle, aka sweet gale, is one herb always mentioned. It's a pretty nicely flavored herb, kind of resiny and piney, not far from hops. Yarrow, Achillium millefolium, is another, although it has a rough bitterness that's not pleasing to modern tastes. A third, Ledum palliser, which sometimes goes by the name of wild rosemary, seems to have been held in lower regard than bog myrtle. It has a menthol resiny bitterness, and historically there are suggestions of mind-altering properties, although this appears not to be the case. It does have some toxicity and is a pretty effective bug repellent. This witch's brew was supplemented by whatever culinary seasonings were available: juniper, caraway, anise seed, and possibly more exotic spices such as cinnamon, nutmeg, and ginger. I've tasted a number of home-brewed gruets, and I can report that either tastes have changed since then, or we're missing some important part of the formula. Hopped beer. The first chemical evidence of hops in beer dates to 550 BCE in Pombia, near Lake Maggiore in northern Italy. But this may have been a false start. It would take another 1,500 years or so before hops began their takeover of European beer. The first hopped beers appear before the year 1000 in the northern German Hansa Trading League city of Bremen. Many of the early adopters of hops were free cities beyond the reach of the church, and as such were not obligated to use gruet. At that time, brewers of gruet beer were known as red beer brewers, making brown or amber-colored beers. Those using hops brewed white beer, which usually included a fair amount of wheat in the grist along with the barley. The guilds for each were totally separate, and towns were often known for one or the other. The brewers of Bremen and Hamburg shipped an awful lot of beer to Amsterdam, which was just getting going at the time and was thirsty for the great, refreshing taste of imported beer. It took about 100 years for the local brewers to figure out that they could brew this hopped white beer in Amsterdam, and they soon began exporting to Flanders, repeating the cycle. Hopped beer eventually washed ashore in England with a flood of Flemish immigrants and was pretty well established by the year 1500. Hopped beer was a success not only because it tastes great, but because hops have preservative properties that retard certain beer-spoiling bacteria. This allowed table-strength beer to remain drinkable for a few months rather than a few weeks. Despite some grumblings about the despicable foreignness of it, hopped beer was accepted into England without too much fuss, and by about 1600, all English beer and ale had hops in some quantity. As Northern Europe flourished, hopped beer became the norm. Parts south, such as Italy and Spain, had little or no beer culture. Italy was rightly satisfied with its wonderful wines, and the anti-alcohol Muslims weren't kicked out of Spain until 1614. The brewing action was in the German states, Flanders, the Netherlands, and England. And that remains the case 500 years later, although craft beer culture has sprung to life in Italy, Spain, and elsewhere. The northern beer cultures are the sources for all the classic styles I'll be covering in detail later in the book. The rise of porter. The changes that would culminate in the Industrial Revolution began in England in the mid-17th century. Many large public works projects to open canals and improve harbors would affect brewing, as they improved access of raw materials and opened distant markets. Farmers were being forced off the land through the restriction of their access to what had previously been common areas of cultivation and grazing. Many of them found new lives in the cities. Simultaneously, London encountered a patch of tough times. The Civil War of 1642 and the subsequent turbulence of Oliver Cromwell's leadership from 1653 to 1658, plague in 1665, and a devastating fire in 1666. The latter actually proved to be a stimulus to new growth and development. Peasants and gentry alike flooded into the city to make their fortunes. And there's one thing we all know about hard work. It makes us very thirsty. About that time, a type of inexpensive brown malt from Hertfordshire was becoming available in London, and it was adopted as the standard malt there. As always, beers were brewed at different strengths, and the stronger sorts were aged until they acquired a particular sourish tang. Such aged beer was called stale, and not in the negative sense, as it sold for a higher price than fresh or running beer. Bar patrons were fond of ordering blends of 2, 3, or even 5 separate beers, which must have kept the bar hands busy. The oft-told story goes that porter was invented in October 1722 by Ralph Harwood in his Bell Brewery in Shoreditch to replace these blends, particularly one called Three Threads. There's no evidence any of this is true. The story didn't appear until 1810 in the book Picture of London, nearly a century after the supposed events of 1722. Whatever the reason for its genesis, the new hoppy brown beer was a huge craze, and by the 1720s it had acquired the porter name. Because of the large amount of capital needed to hold beer for an extended period while maturing, moneyed people began buying stocks of the new beer and aging it for a year or more, setting the stage for the enormous enterprises that porter breweries would soon become. Aided by new technologies such as steam, instrumentation, and cast iron, scale increased to dizzying levels, giving rise to the largest breweries the world had ever known. By 1796, Whitbread alone was brewing 202,036-gallon barrels a year. Combined, London porter breweries brewed 1,200,000 barrels in 1810. At that time, it took more money to finance a brewery than any other business except a bank. This new industrial scale was important because it increased pressure on brewers to find efficiencies that had been insignificant in a more artisanal setting. In a competitive market, Businesses live and die by these efficiencies, but as breweries strive to get the most for the least, the customer doesn't always benefit. The brewing texts of the time are full of wistful quotes telling us how much better the beer was in the good old days. Some of this is simply nostalgia, of course, but if you look at the recipes, changes over time are rarely made with the aim of making the beer taste better. While the particulars of the rise of pale ale are fascinating enough, and will be discussed in Chapter 9, they were very much a continuation of the industrialization of beer begun by porter. Both porter and pale ale were hugely influential well beyond the borders of Britain. England was the superpower of the day, and its cultural trends were closely watched and occasionally adopted. Even in tradition-bound Germany, there was an interest in porter, and the globe-drenching success of pale ale was one of the things that pushed the town fathers of Pilsen to create their famous golden lager. But we're getting ahead of ourselves. Technological changes in brewing, 1700 to 1900. Steam power. Although useful steam engines for mining were developed about 1700, the brewing industry had to wait until the improvements of James Watt and others made them practical for such work. The first steam engine installed in a brewery was in 1784 in London. Steam replaced manual, water, and horsepower for many tasks and made brewing on a large industrial scale possible. The thermometer. Although the technology had been around for some time, it was Gabriel Fahrenheit who created the first mercury thermometer and standardized scale in 1714. The Celsius scale was devised in 1742. James Baverstock was the first brewer to seriously investigate the use of a thermometer, but he had to hide his efforts from his conservative family, who opposed newfangled ideas. Michael Combrun wrote the brewing text, 1784, detailing its use. The thermometer allowed for a good deal more consistency than the empirical methods in use, and it allowed detailed research into the dynamics of brewing procedures. The hydrometer. This is an instrument that measures specific gravity and is used to measure the amount of sugar and other dissolved solids in beer wort, the sweet liquid drained from the mash that is fermented to make beer. In 1785, John Richardson wrote the first brewing book detailing brewing measurements made with a hydrometer, which had huge implications for the way beer was brewed and, more than any other technology, changed the way beer actually tasted by forcing brewers to formulate their recipes with yield in mind. Yeast and fermentation. Around 1680, the Dutch microscopist Anton van Leeuwenhoek was the first to observe and describe yeast cells. Three different scientists, independently from around 1834 to 1835, revealed their living nature. Louis Pasteur penned his epic Études sur la bière, detailing the causes and prevention of diseases of beer, in 1876. With Pasteur's help, Emil Christian Hansen isolated the first single-cell culture, as opposed to a mixed brewing culture. This approach spread slowly, but by the mid-20th century, this was the norm. Single-cell cultures make for a more consistent and, on average, better beer. However, many lamented the abandonment of more complex, mixed-culture fermentation, even as they acknowledged the necessity of doing so. Refrigeration. This was a culmination of centuries of work by various luminaries. American Alexander Twining is credited with creating the first commercial refrigeration unit in 1859. German engineer Carl von Linde's advanced dimethyl ether refrigeration machines were installed in the Spaten Brewery in 1873. Refrigeration offered an obvious benefit over ice cut from frozen rivers and lakes, until then the only form of cooling available. Not only were the logistics complicated, but natural ice was also becoming a health hazard, a result of pollution of the waterways. By 1890, artificial refrigeration was the norm for large-scale brewing everywhere. Malt kilning. Over time, there was a gradual transition from direct-fired, wood-fueled kilns to indirectly heated kilns fueled by coal, coke, or other fuels. By 1700, most English maltsters and brewers, who malted their own, had switched to indirect kilns making for smoke-free malts, although brown malt continued to be roasted by crackling hot wood fires into the mid-20th century. Of course, smoked beers are today a specialty item in Bamberg, Germany. The most dramatic invention relative to malt kilning was the cylindrical roaster, patented by Daniel Wheeler in 1817. This device forever changed the brewing and flavor of porter and stout, as a small amount of this much darker malt was more economical than the large amounts of brown and amber malts used previously. Crystal caramel malt was a later, but prior to 1870, development of unknown origin. Cold fermented lager. Sometime between 1400 and 1500, a cold fermented beer called lager came into existence in Germany, or maybe Bohemia. How, when, and why is one of the great mysteries of beer history. The commonly told story has Bavarian monks fermenting in caves in the Alps, but this doesn't make a lot of sense. A mountain is not a great place to brew or sell beer. Barley comes from the fields far below, and that's where the customers are as well. So grain has to be hauled up, and beer, in heavy wooden casks, transported down. Ice caves are a little too cold, and rocky ones a little too warm. The earliest mention of lager supposedly occurs in 1420, in records from Munich, but this is not well documented. Then, from the city of Naberg, in northeast Bavaria, bordering on Bohemia, we get this. One brews the warm or top fermentation. But first, in 1474, one attempted to brew by the cold bottom fermentation, and to preserve part of the brew for the summer. This seasonal preference must have been established by then, but in 1539, a ban on summer brewing in Bavaria gave it the force of law. However, the date seems a little late to explain the earlier mentions. Lager yeast, Saccharomyces pasteurianus, is a hybrid between an ale yeast and another yeast, S. bionus, a cold-tolerant, osmophilic species, first found living in birch galls in Patagonia, but more recently found in China and Tibet. Genomic data seems to indicate that this hybridization may have occurred multiple times, and it suggests that at least one lager strain is actually an ale and not a hybrid. The Patagonian discovery threw the timeline of the whole story into question, but locating it in Eurasia means an appropriately early date is possible. Whatever the true story, by 1600, lager seems to have been pretty dominant in Bavaria and nearby regions such as Bohemia. Lager developed into a rollicking beer culture and put the Bavarians on the beer map. Because of its landlocked situation, as well as being host to a good deal of political turmoil over the centuries, Bavaria was a little late to the industrialization party. But by the mid-19th century, things were heating up, and the improvements of motive power, instrumentation, and kilning were all put to good use. Much of what we think of as classic lager styles were reinvented in the middle of the 19th century. Progress in microbiology pioneered by Pasteur, followed by the yeast work of Emil Christian Hansen, were especially well received by lager brewers. With their clean, pure flavors, lagers benefit from the consistency of single-cell cultures, so German brewers were quick to adopt them. English brewers of the day tried them out, and because of their short brewing cycle, found them unnecessary. Mixed cultures are still employed today in some English breweries. In the town of Pilsen, in 1842, a number of things came together to create a beer that would eventually dominate the world market beyond anybody's dreams. The beer, Pilsner, was a confluence of ingredients, technology, and a business plan just right for the times. Community leaders thought it would be a good idea to build a sizable brewery to make lager beer and capitalize on the lager boom and the extraordinarily high quality of the malt and hops of the region. The story goes that a brewer named Joseph Grohl actually flubbed the recipe, and instead of a dark Munich-style beer, a much paler beer gushed forth. But this seems very unlikely for a number of reasons. I think when the historians have dug a little deeper, we will find that the parts and pieces were all there before 1842, and probably the beer, too, on a small scale. What the town fathers of Pilsen did was bet big on it, perhaps seeking to trade on the raging popularity of the English pale ale that seemed to be everywhere in those days. In any event, the pale, crisp, effervescent Pilsner beer was a huge hit, bringing its little hometown worldwide celebrity. Bavaria joined the German Union in 1871 and soon sought to impose its restrictive beer purity law. Shortly after 1900, the Rheinheitsgebot, German beer purity law, had the force of law across Germany. At the time, northern Germany was white beer country. Its beers had more in common with Belgium than they did with Bavaria. Beers brewed with a proportion of wheat, often smoked, sometimes sour, and using herbs such as coriander and sugars such as molasses and honey, were very popular. Beers from that time, such as Grositzky, Grätzer, Lichtenhainer, Kottbusser, Bräuchernalt, and Gose, can be lovely beers, and craft brewers are taking notice. There is a minor fad going on for Gose, and some of the others are being brewed occasionally as well. Polish homebrewers are taking a special interest in Grositzky, a Prussian ale brewed from 100% smoked wheat malt, going so far as to interview former brewery workers and resurrecting the correct yeast strain. Of all the northern German ales, only Berliner Weisse and the lovely specialty ales of the Rhine Valley, Kolsch and Düsseldorfer Alt, have survived in any meaningful way in their home territory. By the time World War II started rumbling up, all the classic Germanic lager styles as we know them today were pretty well set in stone. Belgium and France. The picture is different in Belgium. Modernization came in fits and starts, beginning in the mid-19th century. By the end of the century, most of the large-scale breweries were making Bavarian-style lagers, of which Stella Artois is the best-known example. Written accounts of the time describe many of the historically Belgian breweries as being small and dispirited. Belgium's original beer culture revolved around wheat beers. Even those considered barley malt beers, such as Lorge d'Anvers, barley beer of Antwerp, often had a dash of wheat and oats in the grist. Many of these ancient styles are familiar to us today. Witbier, Lambic, and Flanders Brown, although today this style is brewed without wheat. But many more that were popular in their day have disappeared. Bière de Mechelen, Petermann, Diest, and many others. Belgian beer has tap roots that go back to the Middle Ages. Those dancing peasants in the Bruegel painting are most likely drinking something along the lines of Lambic, the sour, wild fermented beer of the Brussels region. Witbier also has a long pedigree. But many of what we think of as ancient and characteristic beers, such as Trappist beers, Belgian pale ales, and saisons, are actually inventions of the 20th century. What you may have heard isn't always the real story. Belgium has been through a lot. Wedged between vying superpowers, it has been dominated by the French, Dutch, Germans, Spanish, and Austro-Hungarians. Two devastating world wars were fought on its soil, and these brought with them calamitous foreign occupations. The Belgians loved to drink beer. Figures published in an 1851 book by Georges Lacambre state that for a population in the neighborhood of 4 million individuals, Belgians brewed no less than 8 or 9 million hectoliters of beer per year without exporting a great deal. This works out to a little over a pint a day, actually 0.58 liter per person, about twice what it is today. If you're wondering, the Czechs are today's biggest beer drinkers at just over 0.4 liter per person per day. The Belgian brewing industry was at a low point around 1900, and then came World War I. Despite the hardships, Belgian brewers managed to rebound. The 1920s and 30s saw the introduction of the strong, high-gravity luxury beers that form our impressions of Belgium today. Miraculously, the ancient lambic style managed to survive. Belgium has never had a beer purity law. This means there was never a purge of the ancient spices, herbs, and sugars that were once widespread in European brewing. Coriander, orange peel, cumin, grains of paradise, a pungent, peppery spice, and many kinds of sugars find their way into Belgian beers, often in quite subtle ways. However, the aforementioned Lacambre notes casually that these are English spices, and they were indeed common in 18th and early 19th century English recipes, especially those brewed on private estates. This historical complexity only adds to the appeal. Belgian brewing is subject to the same kind of pilsnerization and consolidation that afflicts many of Europe's traditional brewing regions. But thanks to a strong export market, half of Belgium's beers leave the country, the scene abounds with fascinating artisanal products and is also starting to be populated with forward-thinking artisanal brewers, injecting some fresh creativity. For a beer lover seeking new experiences, Belgium is a wonderland of the highest order. The north of France, particularly the region of Nord, which borders Belgian Flanders, has a beer tradition that blends into Belgium's. Many small breweries were brewing their own top fermented interpretations of the blondes, bières de mar, marzens, and bocks that were popular as lagers elsewhere in France. These, especially the double versions, have been reborn as the bières de garde we know today. Farther south, France's lager beer barrel was the Alsace-Lorraine region that bordered Germany to the east. By 1871, when Germany annexed the region after the Franco-Prussian War, Alsace was brewing most of France's beer. Louis Pasteur was among those enraged by this act of war, and he set about to do his part to rebuild the French brewing industry bigger and better with superb, world-class beer, which he called the Beer of Revenge. He published his famous Études sur la bière in 1876, which demonstrated the causes of beer spoilage and suggested methods for preventing it. This work was of enormous importance and had effects far beyond France to every corner of the industrialized beer world. North America. The first colonists to America brought with them a taste for beer. But brewing was extremely difficult in the New World for a number of reasons. Barley didn't grow well in southern regions such as Virginia or in northern New England. Imported malt was expensive and only occasionally available. People continued to make the effort in the 17th and early 18th centuries, but after many generations, people's tastes change. And with beers made from molasses, dried pumpkin, and, as one ditty says, walnut tree chips, it's not hard to see why. Easy access to cheap spirits helped rum and whiskey displace beer in most regions, and hard cider was easy to make on the farm. By 1800, per capita consumption of spirits was 10 times that of beer, in gallons. When you figure it based on the amount of alcohol consumed, it's more like 200 to 1. Beer was never suited to the frontier, and those wide open spaces dominated America for a long time. Brewing takes a cooperative climate and a lot of infrastructure, especially a steady source of clean water. Beer ingredients are heavy and difficult to transport over land, and the same is true of the finished product. Whether it was West Virginia or North Dakota, whiskey, rum, and cider were the logical choices for most. In whatever manner people were getting their alcohol, small beer remained important in early America. George Washington's famous recipe of a little molasses and a handful of bran are probably typical. He was a commercial-scale distiller, and had access to imported Madeira and other products for serious imbibing, but still, small beer was vital to the functioning of his estate. The idea was to add just enough flavoring to make it palatable as a source of safe water for slaves, servants, and master alike. After the Revolution, Thomas Jefferson saw beer as a temperate path for a spirits-soaked populace and began brewing experiments at Monticello, but ultimately nothing much came of this. The exception to this dearth of beer was in Pennsylvania and parts of New York and Massachusetts. Wherever there were Germans or Dutch, there was a demand for beer, and these immigrants settled into lands that were able to provide the raw materials for their favorite drink. The Dutch arrived in New Amsterdam, New York, in 1630, and brewing commenced there just 2 years later. Brewing was an important industry. The first paved street in the city was Brewer Street. Brewing continued after the Dutch ceded New Netherland to the English in 1664, but the center of gravity shifted south. Philadelphia became the Milwaukee of its day, a brewing center famous for its porter and ale right up to the lager revolution. Canada, having never severed its ties to Britain, maintained its own version of an Anglophile beer culture, at least in Ontario. 1800s. Political chaos occasioned by demands for democratic governments in Germany and Bohemia displaced many in the 1840s. Those flooding into America had a strong affinity for beer, a culture of pleasure, as writer Maureen Ogle, author of Ambitious Brew, puts it. For them, a world without the joys of a few lagers in the garden on a Sunday afternoon was just unthinkable. They were men of ambition, skill, and great determination, and they set about rebuilding their beer culture here from scratch. Many brewers remained small and were happy serving their local communities, but others had grander plans. Colonel Pabst, August Busch, and the Oehlein brothers of Schlitz dreamed of brands spanning coast to coast. This was a fairly ridiculous idea at the time, for there were few products of any kind with this sort of wide distribution. But as new technological improvements came along, these men were quick to seize on them as a way to achieve their goals. Steam power, refrigerated rail cars, pasteurization, the telegraph, and artificial refrigeration were among these tools. The business vision and organizational skills required to make this happen are awe-inspiring. America of 1890 was filled with a sense of its own destiny, but it was still trying to coalesce as a people after half a century in which wave after wave of immigrants came ashore from Germany, Ireland, Italy, and elsewhere. While each had its own community, the order of the day was to become a real American. One path to a shared culture turned out to be national brands of products made in modern factories that were rock-solid consistent wherever they were found. National brands such as Heinz Pickles, Folgers Coffee, Del Monte Canned Goods, and Coca-Cola are a few, but there were many more. There was an element of modernity in all this, something, happily, that we've gotten away from, but in those heady days, sliced bread, 1928, really was the greatest thing. The same impulses drove people's taste in beer. In the middle of the 1800s, rich brown Munich lagers predominated. Toward the end of the century, pale, crisp Pilsner and other Bohemian-inspired beers started to catch the imagination of the public. Beyond the fact that this quenching style is a natural fit with the warm climate of much of the United States, the addition of corn or rice compensated for the high-protein barley's proclivity for throwing a chill haze, and these beers were seen as simply more modern and fashionable than their heavy brown predecessors. By the beginning of Prohibition, pale lagers ruled the roost. Early 1900s. It's hard to overestimate the effect that the double whammy of war with Germany, followed by Prohibition, the two are not unrelated, had on the brewing industry, and especially the beer culture in the United States. German Americans basically went underground. The beer gardens were shuttered. The royal family of England changed its name from the House of Saxe-Coburg and Gotha to the House of Windsor. Of the 1,300 or so breweries that were brewing shortly before this disastrous experiment in social engineering, only 756 were open a year after Prohibition was repealed, and many of these were destined to fail. A whole generation grew up viewing alcohol as forbidden fruit, which makes it all the more tempting, but in a dirty, creepy sort of way. Quality plummeted. Worse, because brewing could only take place in utterly corrupt locales, such as Chicago, spirits began to take hold nearly everywhere else, with the cocktail capturing the imagination of the drinker as a sophisticated modern tipple. Although the beer industry regained its footing by the late 1950s, beer in America still suffers from this ravaged thinking many decades later. Competition from the soda business was also a factor. From $135 million in sales in 1919, it had grown to $750 million by 1947, and double that a decade later. Soft drinks filled a need for a crisp, refreshing, temperate beverage, the role in which beer had held sole sway for thousands of years. When Prohibition ended, beer started its slow climb out of the hole. Dark Munich-style lager was pretty well finished by then, replaced by crisp pilsners lightened with additions of rice or corn. Consumption shifted away from saloons to the home. Before Prohibition, 75% of beer had been draft rather than bottled. By 1945, this had reversed, and three-quarters of all beer was packaged and increasingly sold to take home. This meant that beer was not only more available to women, but they also became involved in its purchase. The first canned beer was released by the Kruger Brewing Company of Newark, New Jersey, in 1935. The new cans were light, were quick to chill, and took up less room than bottles in the refrigerator, all of which was very appealing to women. When masses of GIs returned home after World War II, having enjoyed canned beer in the intense arena of war, cans were a comfortable fit at home. They were a big hit. Cans, by the way, are neutral as far as their effect on the product inside, even though by the 1980s they were snobbishly viewed as a low-class marker for the Joe Sixpack lifestyle. At first made of steel, and now of aluminum, cans are lined with a beer inert coating and have the real advantages of being totally opaque and recyclable. Canned craft beers have proliferated and are growing faster than craft beer as a whole. Mid-1900s. The other inescapable story in the last century of brewing is of consolidation. The United States had 4,131 breweries in 1873. A century later, there were barely over 100. This is not unique to the brewing industry or to the United States. It is a fact of business that over time, the efficiencies of larger operations, combined with national marketing, the vulnerability of weak producers, and the need to acquire cash for growth, all lead toward the big getting bigger, while small producers fall by the wayside. For reasons related to consolidation and the relatively mature stage of the market, the 1950s and 60s saw a hotly contested race to the bottom in terms of beer quality and price. Bargain brands appeared, and then came ultra-bargain brands, the low end of which scraped against the federal government's requirement that beer contain at least 50% malt. The real low came first with store brands, and then with generic beer that came in cans with no branding at all. A number of different additives were used to make these discount beers more palatable. Cobalt salts were found to dramatically improve beer foam, and this was hailed as a godsend until people started getting sick and the product was withdrawn. By the late 1980s, most of these additives were gone for good. And it should also be noted that not all breweries resorted to extreme means to slice the price. All this financial pressure put a great deal of strain on the production process. As malt content lowered, it became difficult to produce a product that resembled beer closely enough to deserve the name, and brewers were pressed to move the beer more quickly through the production cycle. Continuous fermentation was, and still is, an obsession among those modernizing beer production. In this process, wort is fed into one end of a fermenter, and finished beer comes out the other. Like a conveyor belt oven, this solves a lot of problems inherent in batch brewing. Brewers at Schlitz thought they were onto something big when they flipped the switch on their continuous fermenter in 1973. And they were. But the first batches of beer proved to be highly buttery and quite unacceptable to the consumer. This huge misstep coincided with the conviction for illegal pay-to-play that brought intense government oversight, dooming the brand to hide forever in the shadows, like a thing undead. The final part of the American industrial beer story is the success of light beer. The idea had been kicking around for some time. Miller bought the sleepy brand Light, which had initially been Gablinger's and then part of the Meisterbrau family. In 1975, Miller did the same thing to Light that its parent company, Philip Morris, had done to Marlboro a couple of decades before. Take a female-oriented brand and restage it with a huge shot of testosterone, this time with aging sports stars, the cowboys of the day. Blam! Light and its many imitators shot to the top of the charts, exceeding regular beer in barrelage by 2005. Like any successful product, Light had simply seized the moment and presented its product to a market segment thirsty for its particular qualities. The trend toward light, pale beer reached its low point with the introduction of Miller Clear in 1993. This water-clear beer, stripped of all color and much of its flavor by a carbon filtration process, was thankfully a step too far. It quietly slipped into the dark closet of failed brands. Europe in the modern era. In Europe, similar economic and consumer preference factors have been at work over the past century, but the specifics have played out differently. Consolidation and thinning the market of weaker players are factors, but because there was no one catastrophic purge as the United States had with Prohibition, this has taken much longer. A death by a thousand cuts. Europe's classic brewing nations have a near-fanatical fan base for their traditional products, such as real ale or all-malt lager. These fans are by no means in the majority, but they are in some places organized and very vocal. Even in that holy ground for beer geeks, Belgium, pilsners account for 70% of the market. Over the past century, that style has bulldozed many local specialties out of existence. For now, Germany still has its extensive network of local breweries, but most make similar products, and the pressure for consolidation is on. In a way, we in the United States are lucky to have gotten through the worst of it a lifetime or two ago. When we hit bottom in terms of brewery numbers and interesting beers in the late 1970s, we had no beer culture, so we did what Americans are best at: reinvention. Nonetheless, pockets of real, character-rich beers have managed to survive, even in Pilsner-drenched Germany. From the cheery session beers of the Rhine, to the Weissbier of Berlin and Jena, to the beery amusement park that is Bamberg in northern Bavaria, there are specialty beers worth talking about, and their stories will be told in Chapter 11. In some places, such as Italy and Denmark, where there is not a recent history of meaningful local traditions, small brewers have built an interesting beer scene from scratch. At the moment, Italy seems to be on a Belgian-inspired path, while the Danish craft beer scene is starting to resemble the hop-spattered playpen of American craft brewing. There's been lots of action in Japan since the government lowered the minimum brewery size to a reasonable level. Despite business, regulatory, and economic difficulties, craft breweries are popping up in Latin America, with especially lively scenes in Brazil, Chile, and Mexico gaining rapidly. I'm now getting emails from people in Germany experimenting with radical brews. It's a very exciting time for good beer. England's camera movement. The classic product of England's breweries has long been naturally carbonated cask or real ale. By the late 1960s, this was being threatened by large brewers seeking to modernize the product by substituting filtered, artificially carbonated kegs or bulk cellar tanks filled from brewery tanker trucks. In 1971, the Campaign for Real Ale, CAMRA, was organized to fight this trend. It seeks to use public and political pressure to ensure that real ale remains a viable choice in Britain's pubs. It also produces publications and conducts a number of real ale festivals in Great Britain, including the Great British Beer Festival every August. Membership in 2016 was listed at 175,000. Despite their moral rectitude and formidable constituency, CAMRA has been unable to preserve real ale as the national drink, and it now lags behind lagers and keg beers as a specialty product, with just 17% of beer sold in pubs as of 2013. It is available at less than half of the nation's pubs. Economic forces and consumer attitudes can be battled and may even be shifted a bit, but ultimately, larger forces will always win out. America, 1970 to the present. It's hard to imagine now, even for those of us who were there, just how destitute the American beer landscape was back in 1977. At that time, there were fewer than 50 brewing companies with less than 100 breweries, fewer than at any time in the past 200 years. There were still a few regionals, several of which are thriving today, but at that point they were turning out a bland and timid mix of products aimed at an aging customer base. The few that still brewed a seasonal bock beer usually just spiked their pale lager with a dash of caramel color. Nobody seemed to care about the product. To be fair to the honorable family men who rode these institutions into oblivion, the 20th century was pretty hard on breweries, especially regional ones. Changing patterns of behavior and a shiny new national culture meant that there just wasn't any real need for them, and the struggle for existence after Prohibition had turned into a decades-long cannibalistic orgy of price-cutting, product cheapening, and consolidation. There was some pride here and there, but there honestly wasn't much to base a culture on. About that time, way off in a quiet corner of San Francisco, a young man with an inquisitive spirit and deeper pockets than most came upon one of the last of these local breweries still making a historic and interesting product. The brewery was Anchor, and the beer was Steam. In 1965, Fritz Maytag bought the Anchor Brewery and invested his life in making it mean something again. Most see the ground-up reformulation of their iconic Steam beer in 1971 as the beginning of the modern craft beer in America. It's fitting that this first craft brewery was also a living link to our authentic beer traditions and has the kind of historic cool that you just can't go out and invent. While Fritz Maytag was busy rescuing San Francisco's Anchor Brewery, there were a number of other things happening. Young Americans had been experiencing the classic beers of Europe firsthand, either while stationed in the military or backpacking around. The Whole Earth catalog came out, and even though there was scarcely a word about beer in it, for many of us, it pointed a way to a kinder, gentler, mercantile future of interesting, handmade products in every category, a theme that resonates just as strongly today. Michael Jackson was hard at work on his groundbreaking World Guide to Beer, first published in 1977. Books on home brewing were leaking out of England, calling for such strange ingredients as treacle. And Fred Eckhart published a small but technically detailed book called A Treatise on Lager Beer. Home brewing was still illegal, an oversight in the law written just after repeal, but nobody seemed to care too much. It's hard to overstate the importance of home brewing as a source for the ideas, passion, and people that make craft beer happen. Without it, the beer scene today would look very different. The first actual microbrewery was New Albion Brewing in Sonoma, California, which Jack McAuliffe opened in 1976. It didn't last long, but by then home brewing was getting hot, and with a steady supply of guys brewing and friends saying, "Dude, that is great beer, you really should open a brewery," there were eventually plenty of them that did just that. A trickle turned into a flood, and by the early 1990s, there were hundreds of packaging breweries and brew pubs brewing a huge range of charming and occasionally magnificent beers. By the early 90s, craft beer was growing at 45% per year and was attracting some unsavory types. And by that I mean people who were looking only at the money aspect of craft brewing, which was not enough for a venture to succeed. Not a single brewery that tried to start large was successful. By the end of the decade, there had been a shakeout, but the upside was that there was a lot of nice used equipment available for a cheap price. The craft beer industry is a lot more sophisticated today. Beer quality is high. Marketing is correctly understood as helpful in getting the story out, and business acumen has caught up with the passion for beer without overtaking it. Growth has settled into a robust 10 to 15% a year, and the category now commands about 11% of the U.S. beer market by barrelage, around 19% by dollars, 2014 figures. North America is home to the most diverse, creative, and delicious beers on the planet. The late author Michael Jackson was fond of shocking European audiences with that observation. For well over 100 years, the direction of the brewing industry was determined by its largest players. Today, with big beer stagnant and craft beer continuing to blossom, this is no longer the case. I hope we are headed for an era in which the beer market becomes something along the lines of the selection-rich wine category. When you hear August Bush IV say, "The future of beer in America is all about choices for the consumer," you have to just dig down deep and prove him right. The beer marketplace. Since the earliest times, beer has been sold in a highly regulated system. The Code of Hammurabi threatens alewives with drowning in the river for cheating customers. Today's punishments can be nearly as draconian. For thousands of years, governments have felt the need to keep beer contributing to society as a taxable article and an alcoholic beverage, while not allowing it to do too much mischief. Because of corruptible human nature and what's at stake for all involved, it's inevitable that these efforts can be, at times, misplaced. In the United States, many aspects of alcohol beverage regulation have been left to the individual states, especially when it comes to selling it. After some serious excesses in the brewery-owned saloon system before Prohibition, a three-tier distribution system was set up in most states after repeal, with exceptions often made for brew pubs.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.